welcome you here to Farmington United Methodist Church. If you could all stand up and do the call to worship. God is good.
All the time.
All the time.
God is good.
Amen. All right.
Let's sing some praise. Yeah. Yeah. So that's why we're here, okay? The thing I want to know, do you ever tell anybody, any of your other friends that aren't here, about what you're learning in Sunday school? You brought somebody to the church with you. That was wonderful. You know, that's one of the things Jesus wants us to do. He wants us to share his love. He wants us to let other people know that he loves them. And we can do that by telling what we're learning in Sunday school, right? Or even better, bringing them to see the Sunday school sometime. Wouldn't that be a wonderful idea? I bet the teachers would like that, right? I see a teacher over there shaking her head. She thinks that's a good idea. So maybe you want to think about that. Think about your friends who maybe don't know about Jesus and invite them to come with you. Bring them along. Alright? Now I want to let you watch a video before you guys go into class. These are the big kids. They were baptized or reaffirmed their faith. When you get older, you're going to have the opportunity to do this too. This was a couple weeks ago. Some of you were there.
I was there
when my sister got baptized. Your sister got baptized. Some of the other ones were there. Share their love for Jesus with their friends, and that they might bring them to Sunday school. And I ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, guys, we'll see you later. We're going to go off the fire, but... So it's my turn to welcome you, in the name of Jesus Christ, to the Farmington United Methodist Church, where we help ordinary people become spiritually thriving servants of Christ for the sake of the world. I'm Ann O'Connor, I'm the interim pastor here, and we have some announcements this morning, if that surprises anybody. You're new. And we do, by the way, send a special welcome to those who are visiting with us today. If you are visiting, we hope you'll take a moment and pick up a green bag on your way out. It has some information about the church. If you can take out your bulletin and your connection card and complete that right now, that would be much appreciated. Just let us know you're here. Also, on the back side, there's a place for you to get involved. If you want to be involved, there's some things you could check on that, and I'm going to run through those in just a second. And also an opportunity for you to write down your prayer concerns. So the areas we have for opportunities to serve right now are, we need somebody who will set up the communion elements for this service. It's once a month. The elements are prepared. You just simply bring them from the kitchen and make sure they're all set up out here for us. So if you can help us with that particular aspect of ministry, that would be wonderful. We're also need some coffee hosts, somebody to help with the typing of the prayer concerns that you all put on the cards. Ushers. We need ushers at both services. Those are the people who hand out the bulletins and keep track of how many people are here. We need a special events, ministry event, somebody to work on that team for the children. And so if you have that, let us know on your connection card. If you have not registered your children for Sunday school yet, please do that as soon as possible. They're online, the registration, so it should be pretty simple to do that. And next Sunday, we are going to take a special offering for Pastor George. Some of you may remember that he is the sort of missionary pastor, I guess I would say, in Kenya. And we have been supporting him and his children for a number of years. And right now it's just about time for the children to go back to school, so they need to be able to afford to do that. So that's what that offering will go towards, so, and that'll be next Sunday. And I think that's the announcement. Oh, prayer. Let's do a prayer. Or maybe I'll do that later. I don't know. I'm off the agenda here. I can do whatever I'm off. I'm tired. Whoa. At least temporarily, right? Let's pray, shall we? Loving God, we thank you and praise you for the opportunity to be here, to celebrate your love, and to just grow closer to you and hopefully to one another during this time. We ask you to bless this service and to watch over us as we worship. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Yeah, there's never time enough to praise.
I guess I'll do it later.
So if you could stand up here and sing. Our topic today, as Anne alluded to, is sharing God with the world. I like the first verse, everyone needs compassion, everyone needs forgiveness. We all need a Savior, and that's what this song is about. And our calling is to share that with the rest of the world, because the world needs it desperately right now. So that's going to start this moment. Bye.
He is mine. came to each of us. Lord, we know that you are mighty to save in all aspects of life. And so, Lord, we lift to you our concerns. We pray for those who are sick this day, for your healing touch. We pray for those who are grieving that you might bring comfort. We pray for those who are living in fear that you might give them peace. We pray for those who make violence and for those who are victims of violence that you would work in those lives, that you would make a difference, that you would bring your mighty power to save in a way that we can't even imagine, but that would make all the difference in the world. Lord, we lift to you all our concerns and trust that you hear. And now, Lord, we pray with confidence the prayer that you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. You may be seated. So before I read the scripture today, I want to just set a little background. We're reading in the Gospel according to John, and what we've been seeing so far is John the Baptist and his followers. So John's role was to point beyond himself and to point to Jesus. John clearly told his followers that he was not the Messiah, although sometimes they would be confused, but that the Messiah was going to be far greater than he would ever be. And then John saw one day the Spirit come down from heaven as a dove and remain on Jesus, which was his confirmation of Jesus' true identity as God's chosen one. The day after that experience, John was with two of his followers. When he saw Jesus passing, he said, "Look, the Lamb of God." In pointing Jesus out to his followers, he was basically inviting them to leave him, to change allegiance and to follow Jesus. And that's what they did. Jesus saw them following him, and a rather odd conversation ensued. Jesus asked them, "What do you want?" And their reply was, "Rabbi, where are you staying?" Jesus' response was, "Come and you will see." See, they really wanted to know more about him. And so he invited them to come and see for themselves who he is and welcomed them to be with him. So they went, they spent the day with Jesus, getting to know him. And then that's where our Bible lesson opens up. So I'm reading John 1, starting in verse 40. Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, was one of the two who heard what John had said and who had followed Jesus. The first thing Andrew did was to find his brother Simon and tell him, "We have found the Messiah. That is the Christ." And he brought him to Jesus. Jesus looked at him and said, "You are Simon, son of John. You will be called Cephas," which when translated is Peter. The next day, Jesus decided to leave for Galilee. Finding Philip, he said to him, "Follow me." Philip, like Andrew and Peter, was from the town of Bethsaida. Philip found Nathanael and told him, "We have found the one Moses wrote about in the law, and about whom the prophets also wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph." "Nazareth? Can any good from there? Nathanael asked. Come and see, said Philip. When Jesus saw Nathanael approaching, he said to him, of him, here truly is an Israelite in whom there is no deceit. How did you know me? Nathanael asked. Jesus answered, I saw you while you were still under the fig tree before Philip called you. Then Nathanael declared, Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel. Jesus said, you believe because I told you I saw you under the fig tree. You will see greater things than that. Then he added, very truly, I tell you, you will see heaven open and the angels of God ascending and descending on the Son of Man. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Will you pray with me? Oh Lord, speak to us now your word. Help us to hear what you have to say and to respond in the living of our lives. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So Andrew was one of the two who spent the day with Jesus. He spent one day with Jesus. There's no way his faith is fully developed. But that didn't stop him. He went right to his brother Simon and told him, we have found the Messiah. He not only shared his faith with his brother, but he brought him to Jesus. From then on, in the Gospel of John, we see Andrew bringing people to Jesus. A few chapters later, he brings a boy who has 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish to Jesus. And then later, he introduces some Greeks to Jesus. So Andrew is known for his ministry of bringing others to Jesus. Jesus saw something in Simon. And he gave him a new name, Cephas, or Peter, which means rock. In Jesus' day, going back, and even going back to creation, naming revealed authority over another. And it often reflected the character of someone. For example, Adam means ground or earth, which makes sense as God made Adam out of the ground, dust of the ground. Eve means to give life, or the mother of life, which also, you know, as we think about what those names mean, makes sense. Jacob was the twin who tricked his brother Esau into giving him his inheritance. Jacob means trickster, certainly reflecting his character. Later, God renamed him Israel because he had wrestled with God. In changing Jacob's name, God is claiming authority over his life, calling him to be more than he was before. It was the same with Simon. When Jesus met him, he saw the potential to be a rock, to stand firm in faith. Jesus was telling him, by naming him Peter, that you are now a different man. Yet, it's not until after the resurrection that Peter really grew into that name. But by changing Simon's name to Peter, Jesus was claiming authority over Peter's life. The next day, Jesus was headed to Galilee, and he found Philip, and he said, follow me. Like Andrew, Philip's first action in following him is to share Jesus. He found Nathanael and told him, we have found the Messiah that the prophets wrote about, Jesus of Nazareth. Nathanael made sort of a snide comment about nothing good possibly coming from Nazareth. Undeterred, Philip invited him, come and see. Jesus sees Nathanael for who he is, an Israelite in whom there is no deceit. And by the way, Nathanael, the name, means gift of God. So it fits. Nathanael was surprised. in fact, Jesus had seen Nathanael under a fig tree before Philip even invited him. When Jesus revealed that, Nathanael realized that Jesus had the capacity to know in some way that was more than human. And so he came, witnessed that miracle, and he came to believe that Jesus is the Son of God. And then Jesus said, "You will see the heaven open, and the angels of God descending and ascending and descending on the Son of Man." Jesus is referring to himself as the Son of Man. He does that because that name doesn't hold the same kind of baggage that Messiah does. The Messiah was believed to be the one who would come and overthrow the Roman rulers. Jesus had an entirely different plan. The name Son of Man is found in the book of Daniel and given to the heavenly person upon whom is bestowed the ultimate authority by God. So once again, Jesus calling himself the Son of Man kind of gives that thing, but that's kind of a surprise. In the Bible lesson, we have a model for discipleship. People meet Jesus. They discover in Jesus what they've been looking for, whether they've realized that that's what they've been looking for or not. Their lives are changed. Their deepest needs are met. Then they tell others about what happened and invite them to come and see for themselves. This is how the gospel is handed down from generation to generation. One person invites another, saying, "I follow Jesus, and it's making a difference in my life. Come and see what Jesus is all about." This is the way of discipleship, the way of following Jesus, the way to which each of us is called. We first accept the invitation. We come and see. We meet Jesus. Our lives are changed by him. And then we are to extend the invitation to others. As did John the Baptist and Andrew and Philip. Yet, many of us are reluctant to do that. We might think we don't know enough about Jesus. Maybe we've just started following him. Certainly Andrew and Philip were new to faith and didn't have all the answers. Yet they went straight and invited someone else. It actually sometimes seems that those new to faith have more opportunities to invite others. The longer we're part of the faith family, the more time we spend with other Christians and the less contact we might have with those who are not yet Christian. That means that we need to make an effort to be places and to meet people who maybe aren't part of the faith family yet. Now, of course, I realize many of you work alongside people who don't know Jesus, but maybe you're uncomfortable talking to them about Jesus. See, we might be afraid to offend someone or even be mocked by them. I think Philip must have known that Nathanael well enough that he might have expected Nathanael to be skeptical, to maybe scoff, mock, or maybe even ignore him. But that did not stop Philip. He went to Nathanael anyway. The news was too good to keep to himself. You see, there's an excitement when we first get to know Jesus. His amazing love for us that enabled him to willingly suffer and die on the cross and rise again for us. It creates a joy that's hard to keep inside. It's too bad that over time we seem to lose some of that excitement. Anyway, Philip didn't take offense. He didn't get defensive. He didn't make snide remark back to Nathanael when Nathanael made his comment about Nazareth. He didn't walk away hurt or angry or vow never to share again. Philip took it all in stride. He invited Nathanael, "Come and see." These are simple, open, inviting words. The The only fitting response to having witnessed the grace and mercy of God for ourselves is to share that joy and invite others. Come and see. These are what we are to say to others who are seeking more from life, whether they realize it or not. We're talking about extending an invitation. We're not talking about trying to force someone, Jesus on someone. There's no hard sell, there's no threats, there's no scare tactics. Philip doesn't say to Nathaniel, if you die tonight, you know where you're going to spend eternity. You know, there may be a time and place for that kind of thing, but it's rarely effective in our day. We went to a Red Wings game a little over a week ago. Someone was outside the stadium shouting Bible verses and warnings and threats. In a sense, I have to admire the dedication to get out there and do something, but no one paid attention. See, there's something to be said for the method that we learned from both Andrew and Philip, that they knew the person. They had some relationship. They had some credibility with that person, and then invite them to come and see. The early followers of Jesus didn't hesitate to invite. Why not? Because the news is so good, they had to share with those they cared about. There's something else going on here that maybe would encourage us. You see, Jesus was already aware of Nathanael. He was already at work in Nathanael's life before Philip even approached Nathanael. Whether Nathanael was aware or not, John Wesley, the founder of Methodism, called this prevenient grace. It simply means that God is already at work in the lives of people, reaching out in love before they're even aware there is a God. That means if God puts someone on our hearts, maybe provides us an opportunity, asks us to share Jesus with them, we're not doing it alone. God is already there. God is already working in that person's life. We need to share the wonderful news of Jesus with those we care about, and with those who Jesus cares about that we may not know yet. Making connections, forming genuine friendships, and praying for those who do not know Jesus is important. When God gives us the opportunity to share Jesus' love, we need to do it. If the person we share Jesus with isn't interested or dismisses what we say, or even makes snarky comments, it's okay. We are not responsible for their response. We're simply to invite, to share and invite. We know that the goodness and extent of God's love for us for the world can be hard to believe. I mean, in fact, when we stop to think about the truth that God created, the God who created the universe, loves and cares for each one of us, willingly died on our behalf, it's overwhelming. The news is almost too incredible to be true. One of my favorite old hymns has the chorus, "Amazing love, how can it be that thou, my God, would die for me?" We don't have to convince or convert. That's God's job. We just need to share and invite. Years ago, Dr. Gordon Tenderson, a Baptist pastor from Massachusetts, was crossing the Atlantic by ship. So you know how long this was, right? On several occasions, he saw this person sitting on the deck reading his Bible. So he finally went over to him and introduced himself and said, "You know, I just want to meet you. I noticed you're reading your Bible." And the man shared his story. He said, "I'm Filipino. I was born into a good Catholic family, and as a young man, I came to the U.S. to study law. He welcomed me and offered to help me in any way he could. Then he asked me where I went to church. I said I would plan to go to the Catholic Church. The visitor explained that the Catholic Church was quite a ways away, and he sat down and drew a map. I thanked him and he left. The following Sunday morning, it was raining. I decided to skip church. Anybody relate to that? But when there was a knock on my door, he said, there stood my new friend holding two umbrellas. He said he was worried I wouldn't be able to follow his map, and so he would escort me. Quickly got ready and was thinking what a thoughtful person he was. And as we started to walk, I asked him what church he attended. He said, oh, one just around the corner. I suggested that we go there and maybe go to my church next week. Turned out that the church was so welcoming and warm, he just felt so at home there that he never made it to his church. He said, after 4 years, I felt God calling me to the ministry rather than law. I went to seminary, I became a Methodist pastor, and now I'm a bishop in the Philippines. It's quite a testimony about the importance of showing God's love, of inviting someone and going the extra mile to bring someone to Jesus. This is relational evangelism. It includes a clear invitation to come and see Jesus, even go out of our way to bring him with us, perhaps to church. Who knows what God will do with our efforts? Yet we're hesitant. We get nervous about talking about our faith in a culture that discourages it. Maybe we're not sure how to go about explaining our faith. We don't know what to say. One thing we can do is share what God has done and is doing in our life. Perhaps God has given us peace in a stressful situation. Perhaps God has helped us find fulfillment in a way we never expected. Perhaps God has helped us to let go of a burden by receiving his forgiveness. Or perhaps because God has helped us to forgive someone else. Perhaps we can testify to how we have seen God at work in just this past week. You know, it's important for us to keep our eyes open to where God is at work, where and how God is at work around us. The more we look, the more we pay attention, the more we'll see God's presence in our lives. The more we'll have something to share. The more we see God, the deeper our faith grows. The more excited we become about Jesus, the more likely we'll be sharing with someone else. If you're nervous about sharing your faith, a good place to begin is here at church. It's a safe place. We can practice sharing our faith with one another until we become comfortable with doing it so that it becomes more natural to us. So right now I'm going to try something real quick. Tell the person next to you, or behind you, nobody's next to you, something you like about this church. Just one thing, real quick. God asks you to share with somebody who maybe doesn't
know Jesus really. You'll have the Spirit working with you already, but you'll also feel more comfortable doing it. And so I invite you to come, to see, and to go forth to share. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Let us pray. Loving God, we thank you for who you are and for all you've done for us. We thank you for the ways that you are at work in our lives, here and now. Help us to keep our eyes open to your presence. Help us to be able to share that with others so that the whole world will come to know your love. We pray in Jesus' name now.
Just been informed that Jeff Gassman
has been sure. Sorry, we did things a little out of order today, so that's all right. But we'll get everything up. We'll forget it. So just a quick update. This is not about the part of the project, which is still in progress. We'll see that happen in the next 2 weeks. But if anybody is unaware, the carpet that we have in the sanctuary is as old as the church. It's actually 30 years old, believe it or not. And we want to say a special thank you to everybody who's helped maintain, especially with Grant Castani, for example. For a 30-year-old carpet, you would never think this is a 30-year-old carpet. But at the same time, the time has come to replace it, and we've thankfully got a very generous donation specifically for that purpose. That means we are going to be replacing the carpet this week, which was much faster than we might have expected otherwise. So what I'm asking for today is just if anybody is willing to help, it means we have to move everything out of the sanctuary completely. So obviously we can't get the chairs out between now and the next service, but we'll be doing that afterward. There are a couple of closets here that have some stuff, so if anybody wants to stay between services or wants to come back after the second service and help us with that, that would be much appreciated. I'm also partly saying that, so you're not surprised to be coming next week, and there's this nice new carpet. So it'll be a nice neutral tone that will match and give us more flexibility for future upgrades and things like that. But again, I just want to thank everybody for looking at that project. So thanks, everybody.
Right. You could all stand. We're going to sing a final song. Again, I just love the idea of the song that Jesus saves. It's a Jeremy Camp song. It's more about the how Jesus saved me. You go out there and tell the world about that. Thank you.
Thank you.